Welkom in video 4 of the presentation on fair valuation. In video 3, we defined the notion of a valuation. A valuation was essentially a number, a value that we attach to any claim. And then we defined two types of valuations, namely financial valuations and actuarial valuations. A financial valuation attaches to any claim a financial price, that is a discounted expectation under an equivalent martingale measure Q, while an actuarial valuation attaches to each claim a best estimate plus a risk margin. And we had seen that for hedgeable claims, a financial valuation is appropriate. Why? If the insurer charges the price of the hedge, so the discounted expectation under an equivalent martingale measure Q, if the insurer charges this amount, he can buy the hedge and the complete risk is hedged. An actuarial valuation is appropriate for orthogonal claims. Orthogonal claims are independent of the financial market evaluation, and then the best way we can do is to price or to value by a best estimate plus a risk margin. That means setting aside capital to be sure with a high probability to be able to pay the claims. But let us now have a look at hybrid claims. Hybrid claims are claims which are not hedgeable, but also not orthogonal. So they have a little bit of both properties, let's say. First observation, in general, the classes of financial and actuarial valuations are disjoint, except for some special cases, artificial cases, actually. Financial and actuarial valuations are disjoint classes. But neither a financial nor an actuarial valuation is appropriate for valuating hybrid claims. Why is that? If I have a hybrid claim, a financial valuation does not take into account that there is also a non-hedgeable part in it. Or if I use an actuarial valuation for a hybrid claim, this does not take into account that there is some hedgeable part in the claim that I could use, that I could price via the hedge, the price of the hedge. Therefore, the trick that we will employ is we will enlarge the class of financial valuations to the class of what we will call market consistent valuations. So we will define a broader class, but such that hedgeable parts of claims are still valued with the financial valuation. What this means in mathematical terms, we will see that in a few minutes. At the same time, we will also enlarge the class of actuarial valuations to the class of what we will call model consistent valuations. So the class of actuarial valuations is extended, but in a clever way, such that orthogonal claims are still valuated with an actuarial valuation. Again, what this really means, we will see that in a few minutes. Once we have defined these two new classes, the market consistent and the model consistent valuations, we will define fair valuation. A fair valuation is in fact the intersection between the set of market consistent valuations and the set of model consistent valuations. And we will propose to evaluate a hybrid claim by a fair valuation. Well, what does it mean in fact, what we will do? We start with the class of financial valuations and the class of actuarial valuations. In general, these are disjoint classes. Then, in a first step, we extend the class of financial valuations to the class of market-consistent valuations, but such that any financial valuation is still a market-consistent valuation, so it's just an extension of the class of financial valuations. And the same for the actuarial valuations. The class of actuarial valuations is extended to the class of model consistent valuations, what we will call model consistent. Why we call these classes market consistent and model consistent, we will see that in a minute. And then there is the intersection between these two classes, between the class of market consistent valuations and model consistent valuations. This is this area. This is what we will call fair valuation. So a fair valuation is a valuation which is at the same time market consistent and model consistent. Let us now translate all these things, all these concepts in mathematical terms. Let us first define a market-consistent valuation. A valuation, rho, will be said to be market-consistent if any hedgeable part of a claim is market-to-market. Market-to-market, what does that mean? Well, there is a glossary with all the terms, the terminology in Solvency II, Google Solvency II glossary, and you will find it. Mark-to-market means there is defined as the practice of valuing using current market prices. So mark-to-market is giving to a claim. Evaluating a claim mark-to-market means you attach the market price of that claim. So this valuation will price any hedgeable part of a claim market to market. So what does that mean? We have a claim S and we have a hedgeable claim SH, and the hedge of SH is nu. So the time one value of nu is nu times y is SH. And let us now value S plus SH. We have to value S plus a hedgeable claim. Well, the market consistency tells us the value of S plus SH is the value of S plus, in addition, the price of the hedge. So that means if there is a hedgeable part in my claim that I can extract from it in an additive way, then the price of this part or the value of this part is just the price of the hedge. So what does market consistency mean? It means that the value of any hedgeable part of a claim is determined by the financial market. It is based on observed financial market prices. So that means that the insurance world values in agreement with the financial market. That means there is no risk loading for a hedgeable claim. Indeed, let us have a look at this, at rho of SH, rho of SH, if we have a hedgeable claim. Well, we know now that rho is normalized, so rho of SH can be written as rho of 0 plus SH, that's rho of 0, plus the discounted value of the hedge. So in the end, we find here u times y. So if our valuation is market consistent, the value of a hedgeable claim is the price of the hedge. Now, market consistency is not a concept that we invented. There is, since 2006, more or less, a lot of publications on market consistency. One of the first papers, or the first paper, is a paper of Ramakant in 2006. And in after that, there have been a series of papers on market consistency. Market consistency is, in fact, an extension of the notion of translation invariance. Why is that? Well, if we take a special case for SH, a constant, rho of S plus A, and the constant A is, of course, hedgeable by a zero coupon bond investment, that's the value of S plus the price of the constant A at time zero is e to the power minus r times A. So market consistency is indeed an extension of the notion of translation invariance. Moreover, any financial valuation is market consistent. So have a look at a financial valuation, a discounted expectation under a measure Q. Well, it's easy to prove that for such a financial valuation, the market consistency property holds. So that's the first kind of valuation, market consistent valuation. It's an extension of the clause of financial valuations, and it tells us that any hedgeable part of a claim can be taken apart, and the price of the sum is then the price of S plus the price of the hedge. What does this in fact mean intuitively? If you are the insured and you have a claim S plus SH, you have two options. You can bring S plus SH to the insurer and you will pay rho of S plus SH. Or you can think to be more clever, set S plus SH, the SH is hedgeable, so I will hedge the part SH myself and I pay a price new times Y for that. And with the rest, S, I'll go to the insurer and he will charge me a price rho S. So the market consistency property tells us that you don't have to do that because the price that the insurer will charge for the sum is the price that he will charge for S plus the price that you pay in the financial market for the hedgeable part. So the insurance pricing is in accordance, in agreement with financial market prices. Now we have defined market consistency. Let us now define model consistency. What is model consistency? The definition is as follows. A valuation rho is model consistent if any orthogonal claim is market to model. What does mark to model mean? Mark to model, according to the Solvency II glossary, means that it is the practice of valuing based on modeling. So you value not based on prices that you observe, because that's mark to market, but you price according to a model. Well, how do we translate this mathematically? If we have an orthogonal claim, S orthogonal is an orthogonal claim, the value of S orthogonal is pi of S orthogonal for a given actuarial valuation pi. So what does that mean? A valuation is model consistent if you restrict it to the set of orthogonal claims, then it has to correspond with an actuarial valuation. Outside the set of orthogonal claims, the value can be different, doesn't have to be an actuarial valuation. We will call pi here the underlying actuarial valuation of rho. Model consistency means, in words, that the value of any orthogonal claim is determined by an actuarial model. It is based on an actuarial valuation. So if we have an orthogonal claim, you take a best estimate and a risk margin. You cannot observe these things. You have to set up a model. You have to choose a probability measure. You have to choose a risk margin for it and combine it and find the price. So different actuaries can find different prices. That's model consistency. Let us now combine model consistency and market consistency and define a fair valuation. We call a valuation fair, a fair valuation, if it is both market consistent and model consistent. Where does this come from? Well, if we again look at the Solvency II glossary, they say fair value is the amount for which a liability could be settled between knowledgeable, willing parties in an arm's length transaction. What does that mean? Fair value is the amount for which the liability could be exchanged between two parties. I give my liability to you and I pay you a price because you want to take it over. Between knowledgeable parties, knowledgeable means they are well informed, they know what they do. Willing parties, they are not forced to do that, they are doing it, they have a free will, let's say. And in an arm's length transaction, they are independent parties. And then they give some explanation what this means, fair value. They say this is similar to the concept of market value, but the fair value may be a mark to model price if no actual market price for the liability exists. Well, this is words. These words expressed in a mathematical way could be written in this way. So a fair valuation will, for any hedgeable part of a claim, will value in a mark-to-market way, and it will price in a mark-to-model way for any orthogonal claim. But now there is a little bit of inconsistency between the two definitions. Here, between the two parts in our definition of fair valuation. For mark-to-market, we only look at hedgeable parts of a claim. So we look at rho of S plus SH, the condition on rho of S plus SH. For the mark-to-model condition, we talk about rho of S orthogonal, and we do not talk, for instance, about rho of S plus S orthogonal. So this is not what we do. Why is that? So you would expect that maybe here we should have the condition rho of S plus S orthogonal is rho of S plus pi of S orthogonal. But we don't set this condition. We have a weaker condition here. Only for orthogonal claims, rho of S orthogonal has to correspond with an actuarial valuation pi. Why is that? Why can't we make the definition not more symmetric here and here? This will be explained in a minute. Very important also is that we consider the generic meaning of fair valuation. So it's a mathematical definition here. It's not a particular meaning that is given to a particular regulation somewhere. So this is my definition, let's say, in this presentation. But it's closely related to the fair valuation concepts that you encounter in practice. Now let us have an exercise to check whether certain simple valuations are market consistent, model consistent, and or fair. The first valuation that we consider is rho 1 of s is e to the power minus r expectation under q of s for any s belonging to c. So that means this is a financial valuation. The question is now, is this financial valuation market consistent, model consistent, and or fair? Let's have a look at the proof here. First of all, we have that rho of one is market consistent because it is a financial valuation, and we have just seen that any financial valuation is market consistent. Rho one is not model consistent. Why not? If we restrict rho one to C orthogonal, to the set of orthogonal claims, then we still have an expectation under Q for the orthogonal claim. So this cannot be an actuarial valuation, because an actuarial valuation is a best estimate, an expectation under P, plus a risk margin, which is not the case here. So it is not model consistent rho one. It is so rho one is market consistent, but not model consistent, means rho one is not fair. Let us now have a look at rho 2, another valuation. Rho 2 is, instead of an expectation under Q, let us now take an expectation under P. What can we say about this valuation? So it's in fact, the value of something is just its best estimate. If you look here in 2, we find the following. Rho 2 is not market consistent. Why not? Well, let us have a look at the condition. Rho 2 of S plus SH can be written as the discounted expectation under P of S plus the discounted expectation under P of SH. This one is rho 2 of S plus e to the power minus R expectation of SH. SH is now a hedgeable claim, so let's say it's nu times Y. And of course, the expectation, the discounted expectation under P of the hedgeable claim is not necessarily equal to the price of the hedge. The price of the hedge is a discounted expectation under Q, not under P. So that means that rho 2 is not market consistent. Let us now have a look at model consistency. Rho 2 is model consistent. Why? Because it is rho 2 is an actuarial valuation, it's a best estimate plus the risk margin, where the risk margin is actually equal to zero. Is rho 2 then fair? No, rho 2 is not fair because it is not market consistent. Well, we have here considered an expectation under Q and an expectation under P, and the one was market consistent, but not model consistent, and the other was model consistent, but not market consistent. We will have to make a kind of combination of rho 1 and rho 2 to come to a fair valuation. Let us have a look at this valuation, valuation 3. And valuation 3 is as follows. Rho 3 of S is discounting expectation under Q of a conditional expectation under P, where we condition on the financial market information at time one. So in the inner step, the first expectation, what do? We assume for a moment that we know the outcomes of the financial market at the end of the year. So we know why. If that is the case, we calculate the expectation under P of S given Y. So we do like a kind of actuarial approach. We know why, and then we say the value of S is just the expectation of S of Y. But in the reality, we do not know why. So expectation of S given Y is in fact a derivative. It's a function of the values of the traded assets at time one. So this is a function of Y. And this derivative, we make a financial valuation of it. We take an expectation under Q and discount. So in the inner step, we take a conditional expectation under P. In the outer step, we take an expectation under Q. Well, now we will prove that this valuation tree is a fair valuation. So this will be the first example, a very simple example, maybe the most simple example of a fair valuation. A double expectation, inner step conditional expectation under P, outer step expectation under Q. Well, let us verify that indeed row 3 is a fair valuation. Well, the first thing that we want to prove is to prove that row 3 is indeed market consistent. So let us have a look at row 3 of S plus S age. Is discounted expectation under Q of the expectation of S plus S H conditional on Y. And now we split this expectation of the sum in the sum of the expectations. So we have expectation under Q of expectation under P of S given Y plus expectation under Q of expectation under P of S H given Y. The first part here, this is nothing else than row 3 of S. The second part now, if we know Y, then S H is fixed. So we can bring SH outside or in front of the expectation under P. And what remains is e to the power minus r, the expectation under Q of SH, or this is the price of the hedge. And the price of the hedge is nu times Y. So we found that row 3 of S plus SH is row 3 of S plus the price of SH, of the hedge for SH. Market consistency is already satisfied. Let us now have a look at second part, the model consistency. The model consistency is here. We have to calculate row 3 for an orthogonal claim, and this should correspond with an actual valuation. Row 3 of S orthogonal is, by definition, e to the power minus r expectation under Q of expectation under P of S orthogonal given Y. Now, S orthogonal is an orthogonal claim is independent of Y, so this conditional expectation can just be replaced by the expectation of S orthogonal. This is a constant. And then the expectation under Q of the constant is just the expectation under P of S orthogonal. So we found now for an orthogonal claim, row 3 of S orthogonal is in fact the best estimate. And let us now look at the following actuarial valuation. Pi of S is the best estimate for any possible claim. This pi is obviously an actuarial valuation with a risk margin which is equal to zero. And we find then indeed that row 3 restricted to orthogonal claims is the price of an actuarial value for S. We have proven that row 3 is market consistent and model consistent, so we can conclude that row 3 is fair. So this case here, this valuation, where you use both the Q measure and the P measure, is the first example that we see of a fair valuation. So our definition of a fair valuation makes sense. There are valuations that are indeed fair. Now, I told you already that there is some confusion or some asymmetry here in the definition of a fair valuation. Here we take S plus SH, but here we do not take S plus S orthogonal. We don't define mark to model in rho of S plus S orthogonal is rho of S plus pi of S orthogonal. Why not? This is what we will explain now. Well, Let us consider this property. Well, let us say that the valuation is strong model consistent if any orthogonal part of a claim is marked to model. So that means rho of S plus S orthogonal is rho of S plus pi of S orthogonal, where pi is the underlying actuarial valuation. So suppose that we define model consistency in this way. Then our definition for fair valuation would be more in equilibrium, more symmetric. But why is this a too strong assumption? Why do we have to restrict to a weaker assumption? Well, first of all, strong model consistency indeed implies model consistency. That's the first thing. Now, a strong model consistent valuation is additive for orthogonal claims. Try to prove this by yourself, it's very simple, but rho of the sum of two orthogonal claims is the sum of the rho for the different claims. That's an additive rule. So we can conclude that strong model consistency is not appropriate for fair valuation, as it ignores diversification benefits from pooling in independent identically distributed orthogonal claims. So what we typically would like to have is that the price of the sum is smaller than the sum of the prices, because the whole traditional actuarial theory is based on the law of large numbers that tells us that the claim per policy, the claim of the whole portfolio divided by the number of policies, should be a decreasing function of the number of policies. So there should be some sub-additivity. Here we have just an additive rule, so having a small portfolio or a big portfolio would not make any difference. So that means that strong model consistency is indeed a too strong assumption. Let us now finally look at fair valuation of some specific types of claims. The most simple one is SH plus S orthogonal. So we have the sum of a hedgeable claim and an orthogonal claim. Then you can easily prove that the value, the fair value of SH plus S orthogonal is the financial market price of the hedge plus pi of S orthogonal, an actuarial valuation of rho. So if we have the sum of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim, we can easily apply the definition of fair valuation. We just price we take the price in the financial market of the hedgeable part, and we have an actuarial underlying actuarial valuation for the rest. So fair valuation is very obvious in this kind of claims, which are additive. If you look at the Solvency II regulation, they are very clear for this kind of sums. Of course, in practice, we do not encounter this kind of claims. If we have a combination of a hedgeable and an orthogonal claim, it will not be a sum, it will very often be a product. For instance, in unit-linked insurance. Well, let us now have a look at this. The fair valuation of SH multiplied by S orthogonal. Like I said, this is kind of unit-linked product. SH could be the value of the stock at time one. S orthogonal could be the number of survivors in the portfolio. So for every survivor in the portfolio, there is the value of the stock that is paid out. Now, what is the hedgeable part here? Solvency regulations do not specify the hedgeable part of SH multiplied by S orthogonal. It's obvious that there is a part in this is hedgeable, but is it SH? Or is it SH multiplied by the expectation under P of S orthogonal or something else? We do not know. Let us now first have a look at the special case of this product claim. Let us assume that the insurer is risk neutral towards the orthogonal risk. So that means that S orthogonal is equal to its expectation. When could this be the case? For instance, suppose that S orthogonal is 1 over n, sum I is 1 to n, xi orthogonal. So if we have this case, S orthogonal is in fact the average claim per policy. We know if all these xi's are independent, identically distributed, then because of the law of large numbers, S orthogonal will converge to its expectation. So let us now assume that we are so far, our portfolio is so big, that indeed S orthogonal can be set equal to its expectation. In fact, what we are doing here now, if the law of large number is not satisfied, What we do is we sweep all actuarial considerations under the carpet. We say, in our claim, there is a hedgeable part, a financial part, and an actuarial part, but we just replace the actuarial part by its expectation. So we do as if there is no actuarial risk anymore. Then you can easily prove under this particular condition that the value of the product of the hedgeable and the orthogonal claim is a discount factor multiplied by the expectation under Q of the hedgeable part, or the first part here is in fact the price of the hedge, multiplied by the expectation under P of S orthogonal. So in fact, the fair value of SH multiplied by S orthogonal is in this case the price of SH, the financial market price of SH, multiplied by best estimate for the orthogonal part. Of course, if you look at this formula now, the condition here is much too strong. Assuming that there is not any actuarial risk anymore, that S orthogonal can be written as expectation under P of S orthogonal, that's too strong condition, but under this condition, we get a nice formula. Actually, this formula is from Brennan and Schwartz, was published in 1976, and like I said, from today's point of view, we said this is too simple, but maybe this was the first trial to price unit-linked contracts, taking into account financial market prices and actuarial models. So what we will see here further in this presentation on fair valuations is extensions of this formula of Brennan and Schwartz, but in a more realistic way. In a more realistic way could be, for instance, that this expectation under P of S orthogonal is replaced by not, so, or this best estimate is replaced by a best estimate plus a risk margin, and so on. So this is the end of video 4.